second day of our second week on the attitudes of victory, attitudes of breakthrough, attitudes of power, attitudes of joy. We found out by the word of the Lord that every battle, every trial is an opportunity for great joy. The book of James has given us a lifesaver. We will go back there, maybe in our third week, to see all the other things the word of the Lord has said in that text. But we're studying this week Hebrews chapter 12, 1 through 4. The Bible says in the New Living Translation, "Therefore, since we're surrounded by such a huge crowd of witnesses," we are surrounded by such a huge crowd of witnesses to the life of faith. The life of faith. Beloved, can I plead with you to stop looking for a life that does not require faith? It's a life of faith. You can't work it any other way. Your life must take faith. Don't be frustrated. Faith doesn't mean that you lack what you need. Faith means that you have victory, you have abundance, and if you're going through a difficult time, you know your faith will prevail. It's a life of faith. Hallelujah. It's important that I mention that because some people equate walking by faith or living by faith, equate that to lack. That means if you have resources, you're not living by faith. And they talk down people that have prospered in God and say they're not walking by faith. Beloved, that's backwards. It's their faith that brought them to the breakthrough. Their breakthrough is a testimony to their faith. Your lack is a testimony, not necessarily all the time, but a testimony to your unbelief. Because I say not all the time, because sometimes God is taking us through phases, or we made some errors and God still has to correct them. And so there are a thousand different ways those kinds of things happen. I don't want to be simplistic, but we should stop running down victorious people, running down successful people, and tell them they're not walking by faith. No, they're living by faith. I promise you, no matter how much money God gives you, no matter how many blessings you have, He always leaves enough battles there to keep you in faith. Even if all your bills are paid, you will still have stuff to make you live by faith. Hallelujah. And if you don't walk in faith by listening to God and obeying Him how you spend your money, you're going to come to lack before time, or before you know it. Come on, let me run on, because the time is flying by. He says, "Therefore, since we're surrounded by such a huge crowd of witnesses to the life of faith, let us strip off every weight that slows us down, especially the sin that easily trips us up." We all know what our own issues are. He says, just lay it aside, don't avoid it. Get away from it. Don't make room for it. You're not strong in that area. You won't fall into it if you obey that. He said, and let us run with endurance the race God has set before us. This is not a 100-meter dash. This is a long life, or lifelong race. And you run it with endurance. That's why we'll have to go back to James and see what he said. In a destination of joy, we will see that God, through his process, is developing endurance in us. He said, this race is run with endurance. Endurance. Hallelujah. Well, I want to get to it before we finish. We do this by keeping our eyes on Jesus, the champion who initiates and perfects our faith, the author and the finisher of our faith, because of the joy awaiting him. King James says, for the joy that was set before him. Wow, what am I saying? Ooh, beloved, did you hear that? What is the scripture telling us? That when Jesus was going up on Golgotha, when Jesus was nailed on that tree, When Jesus cried, my Father, why have you forsaken me? When Jesus cried, I thirst. He said the reason he could do it was because he saw a joy ahead of him. There was a joy in his spirit. There was a joy that he could see in the realm of the spirit. I dare say that that joy is seeing all humanity saved in his name. Seeing himself being the King of kings and the Lord of lords. And that the Father will raise his name above every name. Oh, that was a vision of joy that helped him go to that cross. That helped him hang on that cross. Oh, beloved, then how can you and I go into trial without a vision of joy? God, give us vision of what we will be like when we come through this. Give us vision what our lives will be like when we make it over this hump. Give us a vision of joy, oh Lord, a vision of joy. So we can go through our own crosses, go through our own difficulties, go through our own challenges with great expectation, with great joy. Knowing that it is a great opportunity for joy, our attitudes will be totally, totally different. Nothing missing, nothing broken, in full expectation by the power of the Holy Ghost, as he told us last week. Oh, beloved, our mouths are full. I'm so excited about this word. And I'm believing God to change my life permanently by it, and yours too. Love you. Let's continue tomorrow. Welcome. The Lord is waiting on you. Yes, he is. Yes, he is. Yes, he is.